All right. So there we basically divide migrations into three different phases. The first one is the discovery phase. Then you have the testing, which is UAT, and you have the prediction. So everything is interlinked. Discovery is very, very important. You need to analyze what exactly you're planning to migrate. What is the current state of your Jira or Confluence if you are still hosted on a server? If you are hosted on a third-party application, then you know, we need to understand what are the things which we can migrate over to Jira Cloud or Confluence Cloud, and what are the things which we'll have to let go. So that is something which we'll have to understand. Downtime. Are you kind of having any questions related to downtime? If you're migrating over to cloud, technically there is no downtime, but we will have to at least turn your instance into read-only mode during the maintenance window, but your users can still access the content which is available on Jira, Confluence, or the third-party tools. Then we'll have to make sure there is a read-only mode which is set up. Otherwise, you know, the migration is going to be irrelevant, because you migrate over content and some content is left over on your server, which would make things complicated. This is where the planning comes into picture. You will have to do a sandbox testing or a sandbox migration, and then make the users test the instance, decide a date where you're going to perform the migration, and plan things accordingly. Then the third thing, cost. How much price are you going to go, you know, shell out for migrating over to cloud? There are advantages of going with cloud. For example, on a data center instance, the starting user tier is 500. It is like 0 to 500 is the first user tier. And there are a lot of small and medium-sized companies who rarely has more than 100 users. Whereas in cloud, it starts from 0 to 10, then 10 to 15, 16 to 25, all the way to 100. So there are many user tiers, and this will enable you to, you know, plan your budget accordingly and not shell out money for unused users. There is always an option for you to upgrade your user tier. All you have to do is work with a partner company like us or Atlassian. And you know, compare the pricing rates. That is something which I recommend. If you are planning to migrate, you know, you should get quotes for licenses from Atlassian and as well as partners. There would be differences in pricing because partners get some benefits, and some partners pass it out to customers. So that is something which you need to analyze. Then documentation of risks and features. You need to understand that you know, the risks which are listed out on cloud, which might be related to potential you know, access where, you know, your content is stored in a location, and if your company has a policy where, you know, they want to store it locally, content like that. So we need to get clarification related to those things, where exactly are the servers or the cloud servers hosted. So that kind of things is something which you'll have to understand. And we don't generally run into a lot of issues there, but this is a good to have feature since we are talking about a foolproof migration. The last and most important thing related to discovery, always raise a moat ticket. Atlassian is here to support you. Atlassian has a dedicated migration team. All they do is migrations. They don't get into fixing your bugs or stuff like that, but they will walk you through the migration process right from the beginning in terms of estimating the pricing to all the way to providing support on a Sunday or a Saturday when you are really planning to migrate over to cloud. This can only happen if you raise a move ticket, and anybody can do that. All they have to do is set up a cloud instance. And if they are migrating over from server or data center, share their CN numbers and involve the people who are part of the migration, give a description, and Atlassian will respond to you in a timely manner and set up meetings and screen sharing sessions to analyze the prospect of migrating over to cloud. And this is something which should be done at any cost before starting a migration. So that's thumb rule number one.
Yeah, one another advantage of raising a more ticket is there are flags which Atlassian can enable. So all the hidden features that can be enabled from the backend will also be applicable for our migration, which makes our migration easy. So okay. And the next process of successful migration is the user acceptance testing. We recommend the user acceptance testing to go on for 2 to 3 weeks, because once we do a user acceptance testing and we come to know what are the errors present there, what are the features that are missed during a user acceptance testing migration. So all those features will be documented, and it will be very helpful for us when we do a production migration. So during the last time, we will not come to us and say like, you did not migrate these features. We expected you to migrate these features. So that lack of communication will not be there if we do a complete user acceptance testing. So there are various other factors that are involved in user acceptance testing. The first one is the cloud migration trial. A cloud migration trial is nothing but when, even if you have a valid or invalid server license, you can apply for cloud migration trial, by which you will be able to get a 2-month extension of your cloud migration plans with the same amount of user tier which you have in the server. Suppose say you are having 100 user tier in your server, the same user tier you'll be getting on the cloud as well. Without, you need not pay for those user trials. And if you want to extend your migration trials, you can also do it up to like 12 months. So that is one advantage of having a cloud migration trial enabled in your UAT site. The next comes the data cleanup. So a lot of customers have data in their instance, which there are some data in their instance which they don't use. Say like a workflow that was created 2 years back and they are not, and it is not an active workflow. So those kind of data can be cleaned up. So when you migrate the data to your new cloud instance, all your data will be fresh, and you will not mess up your storage also with a lot of unwanted data. And then comes the user cleanup. Similar to data cleanup, there are several users who are in server. There is an option to create user accounts without a valid email address. So, but in cloud, when you migrate those user accounts to a cloud instance, in cloud, you should definitely have an email address. So you can do the user cleanup beforehand to migrate only the specific set of users which you want to migrate to your cloud instance. So user cleanup is another important part that you need to cover during the user acceptance testing. Then once all the data cleanup is done, then we'll concentrate on the add-on compatibility. Add-on, most of the customers use add-on. Most of the customers use add-on to upgrade their features with Jira instance. So, and it's currently like not all the add-ons are compatible on the cloud instance. So we need to prepare an add-on compatibility document to see whether their server add-ons are compatible with the cloud add-ons. And there are few add-ons which in which the data of that add-on can also be migrated to the cloud instance. So they need to check with each and every vendor to about that plugin, whether there is any migration path available for that for the add-on to be migrated to cloud. And also, like, we have seen like several customers having add-ons, but those add-ons, they will not be using it on any space, or they'll not be using it on any project. So they will just pay for that add-on, but they will not be using it. So just have an add-on compatibility document prepared and consult with your users whether they actually need that, and find how many spaces and how many projects are actually using that add-on. So in that way, you can also reduce your cost. And then comes the sandbox instance. Sandbox instance, it is really helpful while it comes to a UAT testing. As a sandbox instance, you can multiple times, you can delete your data and re-import your data again. So in that way, the sandbox instance is really useful. So once we have done with the user acceptance testing with all these criteria, then you will draft a runbook for your future protection migration. So once the runbook is clear, if your runbook is clear and sorted, so there will be a smooth migration, we can assure you on the during the protection migration date. So now comes to the now we can go to the protection migration. So before we start with any protection migration, previously in cloud instance, currently in cloud instance, we don't have any traditional SSO ways, but the SSO can be enabled only through the Atlassian Access product. So it is always recommended to enable Atlassian Access product and verify your domains before you do the production migration. Only then your users will be able to easily navigate your production site without any hindrance when you go live. Then comes once the now we have migrated the users, then we will migrate the data. So once the data is migrated, we will not be 100% sure that all the data gets migrated. So if we see any if we see any discrepancies, we will be migrating in the post migration phase. So once all the data is migrated, we will be using some other methods like CSV to migrate the post migration data.
Great, thank you so much for the details, Divya. Can you please go back to the previous slide? I would like to add some content. So guys who are not familiar or people who are not familiar with Atlassian Access, it is the user management tool which Atlassian provides, where you can link it with your AD on enable SSO, multi-factor authentication, authentication, automatic provisioning, user provisioning, all these things can be done using Atlassian Access. It is a paid product, but there is no compulsion for you to kind of go with the paid version. You can just use the free version where you just verify the domains and manage your user accounts. And if you want enhanced features like SAML 2.0 integration, user provisioning, automatic user provisioning, authentication policies, dual authentication or multi-factor authentication, then you need to go for the paid version. One question which Daniel had is, if you want to move data related to inactive users, that is possible. What Divya mentioned about, email IDs is on server, there is a scenario where you can create multiple users with the same email ID. For example, I can create n number of email IDs or user account using my email ID nitish@trundl.com. Whereas if you want to do the same on cloud, Atlassian doesn't let you do that, since emails is a unique identifier instead of username. If you can always migrate unused data over to cloud and store it on cloud. It's not a complex process. You just perform the migration and take it forward. Only thing is, if you are going with the standard version of cloud, there is space limitations. There is not unlimited space, but if you go with Jira Premium or Confluence Premium or Jira Enterprise for bigger customers, you don't run into that kind of issues. I hope I answered your question. If you have any follow-up questions, feel free to add it on the chat, or we can just talk about it, Daniel. Thank you.